Dr. Cuddy, thank you so very much. And what are we going to be talking about today?
Well, at some point, we'll pick up and continue the most recent book that I've done, The Paralete, Their History and Future, going through that point by point because it gives the background to the Paralete. It tells where they are today, and it tells what they plan for our future. It's a sort of a comprehensive look at what they've been doing in a very short form. It's only about 160 or so pages with a very good index. And it's important for your listeners to know that. A lot of people, as I said last week, have a temporocentric mindset, which means they're concerned with the here and the now. And it's not that they're bad people. It's just that it's been planned that way. And the people today... People today live in America and think that things are just the way they are by accident, but it's not. The music that you listen to, the music that is popular, the art that is you listen to popular, the educational system, the economic system, the medical system, you know, the health, whole health industry is not what it is by accident. It's all planned, and that sounds like conspiracy to the extreme. And, you know, you must be some kind of nut cutty for thinking, I mean, okay, there might be a world government conspiracy, but you're saying all of these things. Yes, that's right. They're all planned. And it sounds unimaginable. It sounds like it can't be. But that's what I try to do. I try to go through how all of these things, not just a world government conspiracy, but all of these things are not here by accident the way they are. And so what I did last week, we actually spent most of the program on what I was talking about last week without even getting to the Paralete, Their History and Future. But I think it's important, and I think we're going to probably wind up doing the same thing now. I'm trying to show people how this whole thing works. And it's not just one element. It's not just a world government. It's not just a world economy. It's not just a world religion. It's all facets of life are planned, basically. Now, I'm not saying that every individual listener, the next song they're going to listen to on the radio, whatever it is programming. It's not exactly like that. But in a broad way, it really is. It really is like that. And so what I'm going to do, first of all, is because my next to last book was The Paralete and the Secret Nazi Plan, and Dr. Stan has had a number of people who've been tracking Hitler and how he didn't die and so forth. And so I want to reiterate what I said last week. All of those things are fine. They're wonderful. Gerard Williams, Jerome Corsi, Harry Cooper, all of these people are wonderful people. They've done a wonderful job. Their resources, their sources are great and so on. But in the end, you really need to ask yourself, why am I looking at this? I'm not saying don't look at it. You should get those books from Radio Liberty by those authors. But in an indirect way, you need to understand why all of this is coming out now. And I'm not talking about Jerome Corsi is doing this now. I'm talking about the Paralete and their sources of information actually want you to look at Hitler and how he really did die. You would think they would.
Hold that thought. We'll be back in a moment. Well, this is Dr. Stan, our guest this afternoon, Dr. Dennis Cuddy, and certainly Dr. Cuddy is taught at the university level. He was in the Department of Education during the Reagan years. He's been a consultant for industry. He's a prolific writer and certainly a regular guest here at Radio Liberty. And he was simply bringing out the fact that certainly we have been stressing the fact that it's recently become very apparent from government documents and from people going to South America and talking to people in South America who had either known Adolf Hitler or knew people who knew Adolf Hitler because Adolf Hitler escaped to South America. And Dr. Cuddy is not challenging the fact that this is true, but he is raising the question, why are they allowing this information to get out at this time?
Right. Well,
certainly in the past, when they've wanted to suppress information, suppress books, they have done it. And they have not. Certainly these books are available. Harry Cooper's book is excellent. And I said, you'll have to get that from him right now. Suddenly we've carried Dr. Corsi's book, but for one reason or another, the publisher doesn't seem to want to be republishing it. But we do have Gerard Williams' excellent book, Grey Wolf, Going into Hitler's Escape, and all of the books have all sorts of government documents which are available, and you'll actually see them in the books, pointing out that the people at the highest levels of the American government, the FBI, our intelligence agencies, knew that Hitler, the arch fiend and really all evil individual, was living in South America, and they did nothing to bring that out. Go ahead with your story, Dr. Cuddy.
Right, I'm interested Hitler's not die, and I sort of put a little hint in my book, The Paralyze, The Secret Nazi Plan, about that. And I'm not saying don't buy the books. They're wonderful books. Gerard Williams' book is great, Grey Wolf, and Jerome Corsi's is, and Harry Cooper's is, and they're fine books, and I would recommend that you do look at them. But, as I said last week, I find it very, very suspicious that not them, but their sources of information. I think Jerome got an email from an Argentine journalist or something saying, look at the records of the National Archives for, you know, German U-boat 520 or whatever the number was. And I'm sure that that source probably knew about this a long time ago, the one that sent the email to Jerome. And I know that Harry Cooper was looking at things with his as they call them, the Shark Group, back a number of years ago. But it seems like only after I started writing about this early.
Hold that thought. We'll be back in just a moment. Well, this is Dr. Stan, and certainly Dr. Cuddy is simply pointing out that it's interesting that the information on Hitler having escaped from Europe and gone to South America has only come out recently, and of course, in each instance, why the authors who have written about it, whether it be Jerome Corsi or Harry Cooper, or certainly the Gerard Williams and his partner, somebody pointed them to the fact that Hitler did not escape. They pointed them to the archives, the United States archives, and lo and behold, you go into the archives, they pulled out all sorts of information that point out that the FBI knew Adolf Hitler escaped, J. Edgar Hoover knew that Adolf Hitler escaped, people at every level of government knew that Adolf Hitler had escaped, but of course the government had put a secrecy clause in there, and when you work for the government and you know something top secret, if you reveal that, they'll put you in prison. Or they may even, it could even be far worse than that. So this information is only coming out now, and Dr. Cuddy is pointing out that the information has been coming out since he wrote his book, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, because, of course, there was certainly this Nazi movement. Went to South America after the Second World War, probably 20,000, 30,000 there, but suddenly hundreds of thousands of Nazis went underground after the Second World War, and of course this Nazi movement is real. It's not the only movement. It's one of the movements put forward by the power elite. If you haven't read Dr. Cuddy's excellent book, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, I just reread it. It's well worthwhile reading several times. But of course this movement is out there. It's all across the world. It has its agents all throughout Europe. The whole idea of the Nazi movement was to unite Europe under German control. And what do we see today? Europe is united under German control. And of course, they wanted to use the Muslim movement. And what do we see today? Why, of course, the Muslim movement is very well coordinated, and theoretically, of course, it threatens the West. But does it really threaten the West? Dr. Cuddy, pick up the story.
Yeah, and back what you were saying about the various books, and again, I know it sounds like I'm putting them down. They're not. They're great books. They're all good books. They're well worth getting from Radio Liberty if you can get them. It sounds like Jerome Corsi is running into the Carol Quigley syndrome about reprints. But anyway, they're fine books. I encourage you to read them. It just sort of strikes me. I believe in coincidences. I do. But when you have a whole lot of coincidences, I start to get a little suspicious. And you may recall how Jerome Corsi, for example, and again, he's a great author, great researcher, great book. I recommend him. But when he first got interested in this, I believe it was 2009, and he said he saw something on the History Channel where this scholar from the U.S. had gone over to Moscow and was allowed to get some DNA off of the skull that was supposedly Hitler, and come to find out it was a 40-year-old woman. I think it was 40-year-old woman. So it couldn't have been Hitler's, right? And this sort of piqued Jerome's interest, and so he pursued his research, and he's done a great job. He has. But it's curious that the History Channel, for example, did this at that particular time. Now, I got the scratch in my head, and I said, the History Channel did this in 2009. And it was in early 2009, February 23rd, when my first article on the secret Nazi plan appeared. And you might say, well, okay, so that's a coincidence. Well, really? Because you need to remember that they had invited me, the people who produced for the History Channel, the Statue of Liberty special. Do you remember that, Dr. Stan?
I really don't, but go ahead.
Okay, well, I couldn't go, and so you did go.
Oh, okay, fine. Yes, okay. Yeah, then I remember it very well.
Yeah, so you went up to New York, and remember you were sitting in that hotel room for a while, and they did an interview, but, you know, you and I both wondered about this whole thing. Well, what Dr. Stan may not know is that when I told them, the producers, that I couldn't make it because I'm taking care of my mother, and Dr. Stan kindly substituted for me for that special, after which, I mean, I had done a four-part expose of what the Statue of Liberty was really all about. That's why they called me in the first place. I also told the producers, I said, okay, here's what I think you guys should do. I said, if you're really interested in all that stuff, then the History Channel should also be interested in the secret Nazi plan. See, so I told the producer. They, in turn, told the History Channel about it. They gave me the name of the fellow who was in charge of the Statue of Liberty special. I emailed him. So right off the bat, we know that early on, the History Channel and the producer of the Statue of Liberty show both were contacted by the producer of their Statue of Liberty special, and they did it for the History Channel, and myself about the secret Nazi plan. So is this just one big coincidence that the History Channel decided to do what it did? You know, you just have to wonder. And I did this in February of 2009, and of course I was looking into it before then because, you know, I had to do some research even then back in 2008. You know, it wasn't like I got a vision on February 23rd of 2009 to start writing about the secret Nazi plan. And so it all just seems, and Harry Cooper, same thing. He was talking about 2009 and 2008, and it just strikes me as not those people, not Jerome, not Harry, not Gerard, but it strikes me as too coincidental that their sources of information, the ones that sort of got them into this stuff, just happened simultaneously. At, you know, not 2005, not 2001, not 1997. And I'm sure, you know, a lot of this information could have been obtained back then, but they didn't, you know, their sources just coincidentally, around 2008, 2009, just started letting this stuff out about Hitler not dying. Isn't that an amazing coincidence? And so my problem isn't that they did this and that they wrote their books, and they're all fine books, is my problem is, do the power elite, who's sort of responsible for stuff and when it's let, you know, open for people to look at simultaneously, do they want people to start focusing on Hitler because, you know, he's the leader of the Nazis and you know, he's an evil genius or something and, you know, he's symbolic and, wow, Hitler survived. Wow. You know, it's almost like people being misdirected to look at a really fascinating thing, whatever it is, and in this case it's Hitler surviving, and they spend a lot of time looking at, wow, Hitler survived, wow, Hitler survived, isn't this bad, oh, our media and the government covered up that Hitler survived, and I'm sitting here scratching myself thinking, well, fine, but isn't that distracting from what the real problem is?
And because the real problem is the fact that the Nazis went underground after the Second World War. And, of course, the thing is that at least 30,000, maybe more, went suddenly underground, suddenly in South America. But they went underground all across the world, and they went underground in Germany at that time. And the whole idea was that eventually, two generations later, they would unite Europe under German control.
Right.
And voila, what do we see today? Europe united under German control. But go right ahead.
And what that all is a part of this secret Nazi plan, which is what my book's about. And I won't belabor it, but I will just touch on it, because if any of you got my book, The Paralete and the Secret Nazi Plan, what you'll find is that the beginning of it is a little bit different from the first four parts that was published in the book I had out just before that called New World Order, The Rise of Techno-Feudalism. I began the book, The Paralete and the Secret Nazi Plan, specifically with Sumner Wells and his divulgence of part of the secret plan in his book, The Time for Decision, which was in 1944. But I'm just going to spend 2 or 3 minutes going over the Paralete and the Secret Nazi Plan, the first four parts, just the first part of the first edition, the February 23rd one, that I had in my other book, the one before that one called New World Order, The Rise of Techno-Feudalism. So I'm going to go through that real quick because it's different from the beginning of my Secret Nazi Plan book, the Paralete and the Secret Nazi Plan. This one, the New World Order version, the part one, I began on February 23rd by saying this. Who said the following, quote, "This state of mind, which subordinates the interest of the ego to the conservation of the community, is really the first premise for every truly human culture. The basic attitude from which such activity arises, we call, to distinguish it from egoism and selfishness, idealism. By this we understand only the individual's capacity to make sacrifices for the community, for his fellow men," end quote. And then I say, doesn't this sound like the communitarian philosophy of today? Sort of, you know, communal communism type philosophy. That's what I say. And right after that, I have a question mark. I then say, actually, it was Hitler who wrote the quoted words in Mein Kampf. And he wrote that July 18th, 1925. And then I go on and say, further relevant to what is occurring today, Leonard Peikoff, P-E-I-K-O-F-F, in his 1982 book, Ominous Parallels, wrote the following. He says, 1982, contrary to the Marxists, the Nazis did not advocate public ownership of the means of production. They did demand that the government oversee and run the nation's economy. The issue of legal ownership, they explain, is secondary. What counts is the issue of control. Private citizens, therefore, may continue to hold titles to property so long as the state reserves to itself the unqualified right to regulate the use of their property.
And, of course, all of these things are taking place today, ladies and gentlemen, because behind everything going on are powerful demonic forces coordinated by the real ruler of this world, who is Lucifer himself. We'll be back in a moment with Dr. Dennis Cuddy. And that's why they let Hitler get away.
Yep.
Dennis, you go right ahead.
Okay, well, I'll just continue with that quote, 1982, by Peikoff. He says, but the Nazis defended their policies, and the country did not rebel. It accepted the Nazi argument. Selfish individuals may be unhappy, the Nazis said, but what we have established in Germany is the ideal system, socialism. In its Nazi usage of this, this term is not restricted to a theory of economics. It is to be understood in a fundamental sense. Socialism, quote-unquote, for the Nazis, denotes the principle of collectivism as such and its corollary, statism. In every field of human action, now remember that, every field, including but not limited to economics. To be socialist, says Goebbels, the high-ranking Nazi, quote, is to submit the I to the vow. Socialism is sacrificing the individual to the whole, W-H-O-L-E, end quote. And that's what's very important. That's why Himmler and Bormann, when they got together in 1942 in the secret meeting, said, look, we probably are going to lose this war. America's involved in it. And they said, but national socialism must never lose. And so that's why Himmler and Bormann developed this secret Nazi plan to deliberately lose World War II militarily over several years, not just, you know, immediately surrender. They needed time to get their people in place around the world. So they deliberately developed this secret plan to lose militarily World War II and implement this secret Nazi plan, preserving national socialism globally. And they said, that is our real goal. And then I quote my book, one of the generals at the time, he was, you know, confessing afterwards, and he says, you know, we're going to win, we're going to control the world, and just, you know, under our secret plan, we won't even have to fire a shot. I mean, that's what he said, we're not even going to have to fire a shot. And, of course, it's a very detailed plan, and as Dr. Stan said, I hope you order the book, The Parallel the Secret Nazi Plan, that I wrote, and is available from Radio Liberty. But that's what people should be focusing on, and I'm very suspicious that all of this emphasis on Hitler, Hitler, Hitler is distracting from that, because when you look at it, Hitler was, I don't want to say he's nothing, because he was an evil, demonically possessed, symbolic head of the Nazi movement, so you can't just dismiss him, but in terms of the secret Nazi plan, he was nothing. He was basically nothing. The plan was developed by Bormann and Himmler and some of the top generals of the German general staff, and you're saying, but Hitler was in charge. Not really. Do you really think Hitler was sitting down, this former, I think the top rank he ever developed in World War One was a corporal, and professionally he was a painter of postcards, you know, trying to sell them. He was hawking his wares at cafes in Berlin, saying, hey, want to buy some postcards? I mean, that's what he did. Yes, he was an extremist. Yes,
Hold that thought, Dennis. We'll be back here in just a moment here. Well, Dr. Stan, and certainly it's Dennis's contention that the German general staff, Himmler, Goebbels, the other leaders of Bormann, so they all knew that Germany was going to lose the war. They realized this by 1942, so they began laying out the plan for one time, of course, having Germany suddenly go underground, the Nazi movement go underground, and then look to begin to consolidate the world, to bring socialism to America, to bring socialism to Europe, to bring socialism to Eastern Europe. And basically, of course, they put their people into key positions all over the world. They took all this massive amount of money that they had actually stolen from other countries, and they put this to work, and they put it into sealed bank accounts, and they used over this last two generations this money to consolidate the control, to unify Europe under German control, to bring socialism to country after country, where, of course, the whole idea is that there will be a partnership between industry and government, but it's all about doing away with individual rights and bringing in this world authoritarian system, but, of course, going along with that, the destruction of Christianity and bringing in this new world religion. And that's what it's really all about, the destruction of Christianity, which is, of course, is what's being coordinated very carefully here in America. Have you noticed how they changed the music of the church, how they changed the message of the Christian church? When was the last time you heard one of our major Christian leaders talking about the terrible things that are going on over in Syria today, where American tax money has been used to finance the rebels who've killed well over 150,000 civilians? Yes, there are a few who are speaking out, but very few. Go ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Yeah, and they rarely today talk about why you may be going to hell. You would think that's sort of important, but what they want to do is make everything really nice and pleasant, you know, and feel good, because it increases church membership, and that way they get money, and, you know, they can expand their ministry, and they, you know, so it's all a sort of I'm not saying all preachers are like that, you know, but you'll find, compared to, say, 100 years ago, you find very little preaching to people about you need to be careful so that you don't go to hell. And what's happened today is hell has been sort of watered down, and so most people think, well, I'm basically a good person, and since God loves me, you know, I'm sure I won't go to hell. And if you think about it, that's not biblical. If you actually look at the Bible is very clear. You have to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, and most people now have been convinced that Christ was simply the Messiah 2,000 years ago who died for our sins, and he brought us the salvation. It isn't that nice. And that's what, you know, if you go into most churches, including most fundamentalist churches, that's what they'll tell you. You know, you accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and so I'm saved when I'm 12 years old and whatever. What they used to tell you, but they don't tell you now, is that Jesus was actually more than that. He was also the Word of God become flesh or made flesh. And therefore, when you say you, quote, accept Christ, you are saying, I accept the Word of God. And then they don't explain to you that accepting the Word of God means all of it. It's not a la carte. It's not like, okay, I accept this and this and this and this. Hey, but fornication, I don't know. You know, it feels sort of good. So, you know, I mean, if I'm only bad in one thing, surely God loves me and he won't send me to hell. Well, actually, the Bible says you will go to hell. I mean, if you look at Galatians 5, verse 19 through 21, there's the list. And I'm not going to repeat this over there, but there's a list that says you do these certain dozen things and you will, you'll go to hell. I mean, that's what it says. And either it's a lie or not. So let's assume it's the truth. Well, number one on the list, not number five or ten, is fornication. So is God a liar or not? Is the Word of God a lie or not? You know. So anyway, they used to preach this back 100 years ago. But you will rarely go into a church today, even fundamentalist Baptist or Protestant churches, where they're warning you about that, that you better be careful, rarely. They do it. You know, some do it. I'm not saying nobody does it, but it's less than 100 years ago. So all this is, like Dr. Stan said, a plan. And what they want to do is sort of mellow all the religions, mellow them, you know. And so, as Dr. Stan said in one of his recent programs with one of his guests, even the Pope Francis today is saying, well, yeah, even the atheists and Hindus, everybody's going to heaven. Well, the Bible didn't say that. You know, it still doesn't. It says you have to, you know, accept Christ. And Jesus says, you know, I'm the way, the truth, and life, and no man cometh to the Father but by me. But apparently, the Pope Francis has a sort of mellowed view of all this. And so, yeah, it's all planned. And we'll pick up after the break back with the secret Nazi plan.
Okay, fine. Our guest is Dr. Dennis Cuddy. His books are The Power Elite, The Secret Nazi Plan, The Power Elite, Their History and Their Future, both available from Radio Liberty. We'll be back in a moment. Dr. Cuddy, you go right ahead.
Okay, so what I was saying was all of this attention to Hitler. When Hitler, yes, he was evil, yes, he was the leader, and I don't want to dismiss him because he was trained in the Thule Society and others in sort of satanic mesmerization, so he could literally sort of hypnotize whole crowds, and that's what he was good. I don't say good, that's what he did. He did that very well. He could hypnotize crowds. So he was very good at conditioning large segments of populations through these mass rallies, you know, and stir them up, and, you know, the Deutschland over on the crowd would go into frenzy and all that. So he was trained in how to do that, sort of a luciferic hypnotism of large, you know, individuals too, but mostly large crowds. He could, you know, raise up the large crowd, arouse their spirits, and, you know, Deutschland über alles, and blood and land and the Aryan race and all that sort of stuff. So, yeah, he was trained at that, and you should pay attention to him. But in terms of the secret Nazi plan, which is the threat today, it was really Bormann and Himmler and the German general staff. It wasn't a case of Hitler was sitting down with these dumb German general staff guys who had been, you know, thoroughly trained in warfare and strategy, this corporal Hitler, and telling him, now listen, you idiots, you know, here's what you'll do, Rommel. You'll send this tank division over here. I mean, that wasn't Hitler. It was the other way around. The German general staff with a master strategist, and they would present a plan to Hitler, and he'd say, yeah, looks good to me. You know, that's basically what went on. And so in terms of this secret Nazi plan, it wasn't Hitler that was doing these things. And you'll find, for example, Harry Cooper, and he was saying Bormann had Hitler and Eva Braun drugged and so forth and so on. Now, he said forcibly drugged. I'm not sure whether it was forcibly or not, but they were drugged, and Bormann was sort of running the thing with Himmler. They each had their own roles in this. Bormann had his $180 billion at his disposal, and, you know, had the people in the 200,000-300,000 second, third-level Nazis going underground in Germany alone, beginning in 1943, because the plan was developed in 42, in the spring of 42, and then really fully implemented in 43. And then Himmler was in charge, sort of the SS guys, and the SS guys went to two successive countries, you know, like a guy would go to...
Hold that thought. We'll be back in just a moment. Well, this is Dr. Stan, and Dr. Cuddy is simply saying that basically by the end of the war, why Bormann was the man who was really running things, Bormann and Himmler, and certainly Bormann had about $180 billion, at least $80 billion that had been sent down to Argentina. Now, I have to understand that today that would be probably 95 times that amount of money, an awful lot of money anyway. Yeah. And of course, this money was being set up to actually carry out this secret Nazi plan, by which, of course, Germany would eventually come to dominate Europe. And then, hopefully, of course, there was to be this one-world socialist movement. They were going to destroy Christianity. They were certainly going to destroy the existing governments and install this one-world government. And then, of course, this... But go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
And the $180 billion that Bormann had, that was in 1943, with 2 years to go. So, you know, I'm sure he got a ton more, but $180 billion in 1943 in today's dollars would be $2 or $3 trillion. So if you figure by the end of the war, I mean, let's just say, you know, he multiplied that by, say, two or three times. So, you know, $6-7 trillion, that's a good chunk. That's a really good chunk. And in 1943 and then 45, you can do a whole lot with the equivalent of $6-7 trillion. So anyway, that's the amount of money they had. And then, of course, Himmler was in charge basically of the SS guys, who had the other part of the plan, and that was to go to two successive countries, to Spain and then Argentina, or may go to Switzerland and then France. And so he would go to Switzerland, then he would go to France. So you couldn't track him back. So when he arrives in France, he would, with, you know, all this money, he would go to, because Himmler had his own stash. I mean, Bormann had the $180 billion, but Himmler also had a stash of money, too, separately. And so they would coordinate, and a fellow might go to, let's say, 30 years old, right? 30 years old SS guy. And he'd go to Switzerland, then France. And what do you do in France is they would go into banking or chambers of commerce or labor unions or whatever it is. And let's say he goes in the bank. And so he would get up with the Bank of France. I'm just, you know, putting that out. I don't know specifically who, and it was the Bank of France, but he would go in the bank. And so he'd go in the Bank of France, he'd look around, and he'd see the president. Maybe the president of the Bank of France had a, you know, 25-year-old daughter. And all of a sudden, he'd get himself introduced to her at a social function, right? And he'd, you know, really promote himself and how filthy rich he was. And he was, she'd say, well, where are you from? Oh, Switzerland. Swiss, I'm from Swiss. Yeah, I speak French, Swiss. Yeah, sure, Swiss. And so he would really, you know, play it up there, and they'd, you know, get together and maybe get married. And that would be the Nazis' goal. And they get married, and so years go by. And so when her father, the head of the Bank of France, let's say, and remember, I'm not specific, I'm just picking up that name, Bank of France, or the Bank of Paris, or whatever you want to call it. And so when he retires, guess who he wants as his successor? He wants his daughter's husband, this Nazi, right? And they're now, you know, so maybe 50 years old or so. So that's how the Nazis would have this second generation. Remember, according to Sumner Wells, it would be perhaps two generations. So part of the plan was succession. You have to get the succeeding generation. That's how they do it, right? And so this is a very, very well thought out plan, great detail, and so on and so on. So the point is, Bormann and Himmler and the German general staff, they're the ones who are implementing it, and Hitler is just sort of going along, just for the ride, you know, on this thing. And so he's treated well and all this sort of stuff because, you know, he's a big name. It's sort of like these retired football players. They get them up, a corporation does, and they send them out for PR, you know, and they say, yeah, here's the quarterback of such and such a team in the Rose Bowl, and everybody says, oh, yeah, great guy, but he doesn't know anything about the company, but he's, you know, he's a good face, you know, to present. So anyway, Hitler is kept around and treated well and in Argentina, and Bormann is living well, too, and so on and so on. So anyway, now that's the secret Nazi plan, and I would encourage your listeners to buy this book. But here's what happens. For some reason, I mentioned last week, there seems to be this great desire, I don't know, on the part of a lot of really great writers and really great researchers to not read my stuff. I don't know why. But I remember talking to Jerome. And again, Jerome's a wonderful guy, great research. And I remember sending him my Secret Nazi Plan book some time ago. And when I called him up a few weeks ago, and I asked him, you know, it was a great job, Jerome. You got a great book. And by the way, did you look at my book? He said, well, you know, I got it. And then I just laid it down. And then he starts saying to himself, he says, I wonder why I didn't look at that book. I'm wondering, why did you look at the book? So anyway, a number of these people are like that. And why is that important? Just because I want to promote myself or self-serving? No, it's not really that. It's that they understand, Jerome, all the people, and the people, you know, looking at Common Core today, they all understand what they're looking at. You know, Jerome understands what he's looking at. And the people opposing Common Core, for example, they understand what they're looking at. But what they don't seem to get, what I've been trying to do for years, is to point out the interconnections in all of these things, because they're really, really important. For example, Jerome, in his last interview with Dr. Stan, is starting to talk about today and, you know, the transatlantic agenda and, you know, that Germany is very important and so forth and so on. And he understands that. But I can almost guarantee you that before Jerome, and I'm not picking on Jerome, but because everybody's like this. Apparently everybody's like this. Apparently he never read this article that I had written that Congressman Henry Hyde placed in the Congressional Register back in 1998. It's called the Transatlantic Education Agenda. And I'm going to just go through this as quickly as possible, briefly, because it all fits. You know, it all fits. It's not just an economic thing. You know, it's not just the Nazis supporting the European steel community that becomes the European economic community that becomes the European Union. It's not just that, although that's part of it. But it's the whole thing. It's the whole ball of wax. It's education. It's the social system. It's the health system. And so here's back in 1998 what Henry Hyde reproduced, and I'd written it before that. And he's talking about this new transatlantic agenda, and what Jerome says was a transatlantic partnership. But they use that word too. And so when I'm talking here in this article that I wrote about 20 years ago, I said, while the implications of schools work at the state and national levels have been widely debated, not much has been written about the international connections. On May 18th, the White House, remember this is under Bill Clinton, the White House released a statement at the conclusion of the U.S.-European summit in London, indicating that, quote, through the new transatlantic agenda, created in 1995, the United States and the European Union have focused on addressing the challenges and opportunities of global integration. Global. One part of this global integration in 1995 was the agreement between the U.S. and the European Community, that's what it's called at the time, establishing a cooperation program in higher education and vocational education and training. The agreement, signed December 21 of that year, called for, quote, improving the quality of human resource development, transatlantic student mobility, and thus portability of academic credit. In this regard, a joint committee would reach decisions by consensus. As part of the NTA, New Transatlantic Agenda, the U.S. and European Union then convened a major conference, Bridging the Atlantic People-to-People Links, on May 5 and 6, 1997, calling for, quote, thematic networks for curriculum development, and further stating that in an information-based global economy, quote, governments, too, T-O-O, are obliged to adapt their economic training and social welfare programs. Get it? It's not just education. It's not just economic. It's not just training for jobs. And it also includes social welfare programs. And then it says, then I say, the conference final report, remember, it's about 20 years ago, noted that in the U.S., ACHIEVE, that's an organization's name, ACHIEVE has been one of the main organizations at the forefront of defining key issues in this regard and developing strategies to address them. ACHIEVE has been measuring and reporting each state's annual progress in establishing internationally competitive standards, and business leaders involved have indicated their commitment to consider the quality of each state's standards when making business location or expansion decisions. Okay? And it goes on and on and on. But the point is, where have you heard that word ACHIEVE before? Last week I told you that ACHIEVE, 20 years later, meaning today, is the agent to implement Common Core. That's the agent. And one of the people, as I said last week, who's developing the standards for this is David Coleman, who's with the College Board. The College Board. David Coleman. Now, why David Coleman? He's only 45 years. Why? He's a Rhodes Scholar. Remember, the Rhodes Scholar, the Cecil Rhodes Plan, to get your people in key positions. All right, yesterday, what do we have? If you saw the news, ABC, NBC, CBS, New York Times, what did you see in the news? You saw that all of a sudden, suddenly, Kathleen Sebelius is leaving. You know, the head of the disaster known as Obamacare and its rollout? She's just decided to leave. Golly. No, why? Why did she leave? Well, we know why she left. She was only being kept around for a time to get to this stage of the debacle, the planned debacle. Remember, a planned debacle. And so now, who should appear on the scene? Who did it say in the news? If you read the New York Times this morning, who did it say was replacing Kathleen Sebelius, who took us up to this point, the planned debacle through to this point? Who's replacing her? I'm pausing for a moment.
Because I don't know.
Sylvia Matthews.
Okay.
And who is Sylvia Matthews? Guess. A Rhodes Scholar. Another Rhodes Scholar. And if you people have actually looked at my book, which they don't, Secret Records Revealed, which came out about 17 or so years ago, 1994, 20 years ago, Secret Records Revealed, you will see a list in there under 1993 of the young new appointees by Bill Clinton. And this one, Sylvia Matthews, was with the National Economic Council, the White House Council. Sylvia Matthews. She was young at the time. But she's strategically placed then, and she's being strategically placed now to head up HHS and do the next phase of the debacle known as Obamacare. This is not coincidental, people. This is not coincidental. These Rhodes Scholars are placed strategically for these reasons. But I guarantee you, even most people who listen to this program that I'm on now do not know that. I don't know why. But if the people who listen to this program had actually gotten my book 20 years ago, Secret Records Revealed, and he actually read the book, then that name would be familiar to you. For some reason, it's not for me. I don't know why. So anyway, I'm just trying to say this is what I do. I try to piece these puzzles together so that the people will see the larger picture and see how it's not just economic, it's not just the world religion, it's not just the music, it's not just the art, it's not just the world government, it's not just the global socialized medical health system. But it is all very, very carefully coordinated from a long, long time ago. And so that's if I get nothing else through, maybe somebody will start looking at this stuff that I try and write. And please look at the article. The books that are offered at Radio Liberty, I try to put them in the book. And please look at my articles on newswithviews.com because I try to put this stuff in the articles as well. And if you actually do look at all this stuff, you'll get a good grasp of how it all fits together. Otherwise, you're just going to get these single little pictures. You'll be all up with arms about the Hitler survived, or you'll be all, into Common Core. And you won't see how it's all interconnected, all planned from a long, long time ago. And so now, we have very little time to get into the current book, The Paralete, Their History and Future. But what I would encourage you to do, listeners, is I would encourage you to order that book from Radio Liberty, The Paralete, Their History and Future. Now, why am I encouraging that? I've encouraged it. Dr. Stan encourages it, a lot. But I'm really encouraging you to do it now because it's only been out 7 months, and the publisher just called me, I think, yesterday or the day before and said, guess what? We're sold out. So that book's sold out. So if you're going to get it from Radio Liberty, you need to get it. You need to get it now because they'll probably reprint it. I think they're going to reprint it. They said they're going to reprint it. But if they reprint it, it's not going to be for at least 2 months, maybe 3 months. So if you're listening, you need to call Radio Liberty right away and get that book because it's really sold very, very, very well. And so where we are in that particular book, The Paralete, Their History and Future, we have relatively little time. But we're in this chapter that I call A Bold New World and Forces Too Powerful. And A Bold New World is really interesting in the chapter. You will see in that particular chapter, I include a picture from The Economist magazine, their cover from January 9th of 1988. And the reason that cover is important is I'm trying to convince people, and the people I talk to where I am, I'd say, look, you know, I'm not just dreaming this stuff. I'm not just theorizing it. This isn't just me, you know, thinking and here's Cuddy's theory. I actually try to have the documents. I have to try the, I find the, you know, speech by Woodrow Wilson at Carnegie Hall in 1912, you know, and stuff. I try to get the documents. And in this case, I put a picture of the cover of The Economist from January 9th of 1988. Remember, The Economist is connected British intelligence, and British intelligence is all part of this Cecil Rhodes thing, you know, and the Milner Group and Cecil Rhodes, the secret society, and the whole nine yards. And what the cover on that is says, get ready for a world currency. And inside, it's the article on it is titled Pencil in the Phoenix for 2018. And so you'll see a picture of that. And in there, I describe how not only they said then to look for 2018, but I put quotes since then within the last 3 or 4 years by world finance ministers from the G8 and G7 and G whatever, saying, yeah, it looks like we're going to have a world currency in 2018. Now, you're not going to read that, you know, in the Washington Post. But if you know where to look, you will find that that's what they're talking about. And also the fellow who developed the world order currency unit, the WOKU, his name is Sassioli, which is in several countries already. It's not going to work either, but he developed it. He, too, said in a publication called Coin Update, yeah, looks like 2018 will be the world currency.
And so it's basically a one-world government, yep. A one-world currency, yep. A one-world religion. Yep. With certainly we join all religions together. All religions are good, and everybody gets to heaven.
Right.
And then, of course, this, go right ahead, Dennis.
Yeah, and so that's why I put these types of things in this book, and you'll actually see the picture. It's January 9th, 1988. And so what's important about this particular chapter is, once again, I try to give a historical look, and people like John Foster Dulles. Now, Jerome Corsi and others will mention John Foster Dulles, the Secretary of State, and his role with Brown Brothers Harriman and, you know, the Nazis and so forth. But it's actually more than that. That's why I go back into the Dulles' past. Now, they were young fellows, Alan and John Foster Dulles, and they were at the Colonel House's inquiry group, which went over to Paris, you know, the Woodrow Wilson, the 14 points, and the Treaty of Versailles, and so forth and so on. So all of these people don't just pop up in the 1940s as head of the OSS. They've been carefully placed years before to do what they eventually did in the 1940s, and the 50s, and the 60s, and how come Alan Dulles was on the Warren Commission, as Dr. Stan has reminded people.
Hold that thought. Hold the thought. We'll be right back. Well, Dennis, you've got 3 minutes to wrap up the program.
Okay, well, I'll just give an example. This is a lecture titled A Basis for the Peace to Come. It's called, and John Foster Dulles is part of this lecture. His lecture was titled Toward World Order. Now, remember, this is way back. He says, we have found that regional integration is not alone adequate. We must find a system of government which can exercise jurisdiction which is worldwide. Let us first consider the solution of world government. He uses that term. Now, remember, this is way before the end of World War II. He says, it involves an organization dedicated to the general welfare, the peace and order of mankind, and the assuming of an allegiance to this goal superior to that of any national allegiance. by these initial steps, we will have begun that dilution of sovereignty which all enlightened thinkers agree to be indispensable. See, so way back, 50 years or so before Brzezinski in 1995 starts talking about, we're not going to get through world government through one quick leap. We'll have to have regional organizations first. This is 50 years before Brzezinski says that. Here you have John Foster Dulles, and who after says this, Eisenhower makes the Secretary of State. He's the last guy I would have made a Secretary of State, saying we need to dilute national sovereignty and have this world government instead. But Eisenhower did it, and next week you'll find out why.
Okay, fine. Anything else you want to cover, or shall we just wrap it up?
Well, that's it. President Eisenhower would choose that man to be a Secretary of State, even though Dulles had those views regarding national sovereignty.
And, you know, the thing is that, Dennis, nobody ever wants to say that these people are subversive. They want to do away with national sovereignty, which is the definition of sovereignty, of subversion. They want to subvert our form of government.
Yep.
Why doesn't anybody use that word, subversive?
No, they don't. And the reason is, and I found this out a long time ago, Strobe Talbott said national sovereignty is not such a great idea, the case for world government is clinched, and 96 U.S. senators, and a lot of conservatives, voted to approve that guy's number two at the State Department. That told me all I needed to know right there.
Well, we got a real problem. Anyway, God bless. We'll talk to you again next week.
Thanks, man.
Bye-bye. Okay, fine. That was Dr. Dennis Cuddy, and we'll be back in just a moment to wrap up today's program. Well, this is Dr. Stan, and of course, Dr. Cuddy was just saying the woman who's going to become the new Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare suddenly just happens to be a Rhodes Scholar. And what you must understand is that the Rhodes Scholars really control our government. You hear a lot, you see a lot of articles in the conservative publications about Valerie Jarrett, who meets with suddenly the Obamas on a regular basis. She has dinner with them every night. Supposedly, she is the person who is controlling the Obama administration. Is she really, or is there somebody else there that maybe they're not telling you about? Yes, that person is Susan Rice. Who is Susan Rice? Well, suddenly, formerly, she was the American Ambassador to the United Nations, but today she is the National Security Advisor. She lives in the White House. She deals with the President. And who is Susan Rice? Well, let's see now. She's a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. She came from the Trilateral Commission. Oh, yes. She is just happens to be a Rhodes Scholar. And when you understand this whole thing goes back to the secret society that was created at Oxford back, certainly in 1891, it was all about being about a one-world government. A one-world government, a one-world currency, a one-world religion, destroying Christianity, and uniting the world. And this is what it's all about. The United States of America, and then we're to have the North American Union with Mexico, Canada, the United States joined together in the United States of North America, and that's, of course, why they're allowing all the immigrants to come in from Mexico and from the rest of this hemisphere. They want to unite this area. And then, of course, we have the United States of Europe. They call it the European Union. And the same thing is happening all throughout the world. And they focus your attention on wars. And not to say we're not going to have a war, yes. There's going to be another great and horrible war. And out of the chaos of that, people will say, well, we're going to have a world government. After all, we've killed hundreds of millions, if not billions of people. That's what the First World War was all about, was to create this horror, totally unnecessary war. 21 million people died, and hundreds, and they suddenly met, probably 40 million were wounded. But it was to bring about League of Nations, and when that failed, they had to have World War II, and that's why we funded the Nazis all during the war. If you don't have an enemy, how can you have a war? And if you doubt that, you need to get John Loftus's book, America's Nazi Secret, or my four interviews with him. The war against the Jews, vitally important. It documents the fact we financed the Nazis all during the war, before the war, during the war, and that, of course, did Hitler escape? The 4CD set, you'll find out. We helped the Nazis escape to South America, and we have another 4CD set. Operation Paperclip, interviews, the things you're not going to hear on the controlled media, because most of the media is controlled. If you doubt it, you need to get the book, The New Media Monopoly by Professor Ben Bagdikian. Of course, he thinks the right wing controls the media. The right wing thinks the left wing controls the media, but it's controlled by the Brotherhood. The Brotherhood of Darkness. It has lots of names, the power elite. Suddenly the invisible government, the secret government. Suddenly we could give you dozens of different descriptions, but it's all the same one world satanic movement. Because behind everything going on are powerful spirits, forces, and we're involved in the spirits of battle for the souls of men and the survival of Christian civilization. And we're losing that because they've infiltrated the media. They control the media. They've infiltrated our churches, they control religion, and they largely control what the vast majority of the American people think and believe. If you want to get the information, our telephone number, 1-800-544-8927, 1-800-544-8927. Go to our website, radioliberty.com. That's radioliberty.com, where you can watch our DVDs, or you can certainly listen to our programs live 4 hours a day, archived 24 hours a day, or you can read our newsletters, and certainly going back almost 20 years, and then we ask you to pray for America, for our provision and our protection. Let us